Good to see you. Glad to be here.
So our point today is that we're entering into year three And the Holy Ghost got a plan for us. Now, we have some big things that God has called us to. If you don't know these big things, then you need to spend some time praying and asking the Lord to speak to you about what great and big things God has for us. Now, sometimes we've been looked at as the new kids on the block. Sometimes we've been looked at as the small crew on the block. Some of us, we've looked at as the weird folks. But we have a calling. And God has had us to move forward and to be able to continue because God has a plan for us. This is David, so I'm going by those a little bit. But this week, I had a brother who came to me and he told me, he said, you know, I'm just scared to visit your church. I said, well, why, brother? He said, because you know what? I have been abused by church all my life. He told me about how one day he came in the church and he said he had to keep switching churches because he'd get quiet and he'd come in the church and he stays in the back and he's quiet. And then what happened? He opens his mouth and says, hey, girl! And then what happened? The whole sermon, y'all know what happened. The sermon changed. They start preaching at you. And we've got to understand that we have been given power and we have been called to touch those who other churches maybe have turned away or mistreated. Now, one of the big things about who we are is we have a distinction. We are a spirit-filled ministry. Now, sometimes we go like the old-time folk. We say, oh, y'all the old-time Pentecost. We're not an old-time Pentecost. We're a new-time Pentecost. We're doing a new thing, and the Holy Spirit is doing a new thing in our lives and in our community. And don't forget that. Can I get an amen? Yes. Y'all seem quiet today. So what does the Holy Spirit first want to do for us? We need to get a little refresher course. Because one of the biggest things about the Holy Ghost that we think is the Holy Ghost just makes us play a tambourine, bump and shout, and feel the chilling dog, get the little, you know. First thing the Holy Spirit does is that we need to understand that the Holy Spirit is God. And he's God who lives inside of us. Who's ever felt weak? Anybody ever felt weak and beat up and broke down? Do you know you have a power source inside of you? Glory to God! Sometimes we forget that. Sometimes just because maybe we haven't been in the Word, you know how we get it. And one of the things that messed me up is, you know, on that little Bible app, it tells you when the last time you went to that verse. And so when you go to your Bible app and it doesn't say, oh, I've been in the Bible, oh, it doesn't say anything, you just never read it. Chances are that may be holding the Holy Ghost back from working in your life. Sometimes we go in our lives and we put other stuff in our heart. We often talk about this as a song called the God-shaped hole. So what do? We stick things in that hole that God has in our heart, that God's supposed to be. We stick all type of other things in there. But we will get to that later. The Holy Spirit doesn't make us just be extra and shout. I love that you can shout all you want to, but the bottom line is after you shout, I want to see some fruit. I want to see you live for the Lord. In fact, I was telling brothers today, we were talking, and I said that if you go out here and you shout and fall out, you know what? At least if you're going to shout, you're going to fall out, you're going to go out there and sing. At least don't lie about it. Don't go out there because, first of all, if you lie about it, you can't get it fixed because you're walking in pride. And remember, the first sin was pride. We go out here, we love to talk about sexual immorality. The first sin was pride, not sexual immorality. Pride will mess you up. Pride will go out there and keep you locked in every other sin. And you sitting here lying to folk? Help me, Holy Ghost. We done seen you on every single website. We done seen you out there with your sign out there on the side of the road. And then I'll pass you with your sign out on the side of the road and seeing your pictures on the internet. And then what happened? You come out here and tell me, oh, that won't be. Amen. Let's move on. Amen. What are some of the things that the Holy Spirit is going to call us to do in this new year? school. You gotta understand, you gotta get this, because that's the way we were raised. Y'all, we were raised that you go out here to church and you get the Holy Ghost and you run around the circle of the church and you fall out your body, you roll, and some of y'all remember that. But we ain't doing nothing with it. I taught this before. One day, I talked about how in one of the fellowships that I was in, you think when the civil rights movement that was going on, do you think the people didn't shout and speak in tongues and run the aisle who were in the Klan suits? Let me tell you, it's time for us to understand that when we go and get God in our heart, we got to do something with that. So number one, what we're going to do, we need to stand up, and what we have been called to in this year three is to overcome hate, intolerance, and traditionalism, and the spirit of religion in this area. Now, I've said this, and I ain't going to talk about this area too much, but one of the things, I've lived in Alabama, and I will tell you, I have never met, even from Alabama, compared to Alabama, the churches here are so traditional. Do you know somebody went off on me on YouTube because we did communion and they said the oil won't right? And they preached us down. They said, do you know you're not supposed to, why do y'all do it that way? Look at that spirit of religion in this area. You gotta understand what religion is versus relationship. We follow Jesus. We don't follow rules. We follow Jesus. And this cat out here was out here just letting me have. Because we ain't do communion right.
That's okay.
But that's one of the worst parts about this area. I've never seen anything like it. If you don't dress the right way, folk talk about you. If you don't, one of the big things, especially in Pentecostal, do you baptize in Jesus' name? Do you baptize the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost? And folk will leave the church because you didn't baptize right. I done heard people that they don't dunk you right amount of times. Let me tell you, we did baptisms out in November in the river. You got done one time. You go out there, they said, ask me, they said, how does it feel being out there? I said, oh, it's fine. The water's fine, because after you're in there about 5 minutes, you don't feel the rest of your body. But this area not only has been that place where we've had a spirit of religion and traditionalism, and people get upset because people love tradition. People think they're really doing something for God when they do something traditional. They put a little, how many folk, how many folk do we know on the internet got a little collar on them and we know their life is a hot mess because they follow religion. A bunch of rules and regulations, and they know how to shout when they're supposed to, but then they go out there and they don't know how to love nobody. Amen. Acts chapter 10. Some of us have been called unclean. Some of us have been called. What does this thing work my spirit today? Some of us have been called. What is it? Detestable. Some of us have been called sinners and unclean. But you need to understand, according to Acts chapter 10, those who have been called unclean are going to receive the Spirit and are going to work and be known for the works of God. Now, in Acts chapter 10, what it is the story of the Gentiles. Now, the Gentiles were the non-Jews. Now, on Acts chapter 2, I'm going to teach you a little bit. The Jewish people and the Jewish converts got the Spirit. But then what happens? There were some Gentiles who were not Jews. And you know what? The Jewish leaders, all they went over there, they were like, well, I don't know these people. You know, you got to convert to Jew. You got to convert and get into our religion to go and to be accepted by God. So what happens? The Gentiles come over here. And what happened? Peter starts talking to them. And what happened? It says they begin to praise God and speak in other tongues. And it says the building where they were at shook. Let me tell you something. This is the whole point. I was talking about this on Tuesday, the book, The Children of Free. That's where the term comes from, The Children of Free. It's because you know what? When the Lord touches you and calls you, nobody else can call you unclean. And let me tell you, in this community, I have great respect for all of these people who have come out here and have done things the way it used to be done, in the traditional way, and I followed the traditions. But you know what? Like Carl DePierce would say, sometimes they can go up with us to the water, but they can't cross over. We've got to go out here and we've got to understand that now we are called. Let me tell you, that church can call us abominations all day long down the street. But you know what? You know what Jesus says? You are my chosen people. Now receive the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We need to go out here and another thing, like we were talking today, we don't argue with people. We just let them see the work of God in our life. We don't argue with nobody. Another thing I did want to go even more specific is that we need to understand that there are still people getting abused out there. There are still people who feel that God hates them for who they are. There are people who still wear the L, the B, the G, or the T, and they feel that God hates them for that. We need to go get them. And I want to make it very clear, because the Lord laid this on my heart. We sometimes come here and we think that we need to wait for God to bring them. No, 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 no. The Bible says in Acts chapter, it says we go out and get them. And then what does it say? In Matthew, it says if they don't come, it says beat the bushes. Drag them out. Woo! Lord Jesus, we got to go ahead, because people are hurting. Do you realize how abused people are? God has called us to reach those people. God has called us to reach that community. And not just the LGBT community. He wants us to reach the entire community. We need to be under them branches. The Bible don't say go under the bridge and talk. It's to drag them out to church. Tell them God loves them. Amen. I feel this thing. Y'all so quiet today. I feel this thing got up inside of me, because I believe that there are so many people who are hurting and distraught, and we've got to go tell them that Jesus loves them. What are some other things, real quick, that God has called us to in this new year? He's called us to leave the past things in the past, and it's time for us to grow up spiritually. It's time for us to follow God with our whole hearts. Sometimes we don't follow God with our whole hearts, or we have special days that we follow God. We give God Sunday, Tuesday, and then maybe Thursday. But on Friday, it's time to turn up. And we go out there and we blow everything. We mess up everything we did all the other week, because we done turned up. We talked about, we supposed to drop it like it's hot, and we done dropped it, and everybody got videos, and we talk about, oh, that's the deacon at the church. And you know how they do it. We go out here, we got the video for everything. You go somewhere and eat wrong, they got a video. But what the Lord is saying is we need to start getting our lives shaped up. Again, we need to take that stuff out of that God-shaped hole in that heart. We got so much stuff, and you can actually, the Bible talks about self-inventory. It doesn't say let God work out your salvation. It says you work out your own salvation. Then y'all gotta see what's inside your heart. And I guarantee this, if you go out there and you allow the Spirit and allow the things of God to fill your heart, you will not ever be in a place where you feel like you're in a place of lack. Some of the things that we have filled our heart with, we fill again with religion and tradition. We think because we go to church every once in a while that we sanctify the Savior. Another thing we feel relationships. I talked about this actually with that Pastor Rock Church. If you want to ask me questions, don't ask me now, because we'll be here all day, because I can tell you the stories. But bad broken relationships. I sit out there in a bad broken relationship. Heaven forbid. Now some of us, I'm going to say this, some of us got to get the dog food out of the way so we get the steak. Let me tell you something. Xavier paid his bills. And sometimes it pay my bills, a lot of times pay my bills. But you're for people, amen. But you know what? We the half over, we pay their bill, they pay nothing for us. We got folk who, we to go out there, we go out there and we pay their bill, we pay their car note, and then we ask them one day when we get a bad day, they want to buy us a little stack of Popeyes. And so so what happens is we hold on to those relationships and we hold on to those people in our lives because they're filling our lives, because we feel like we're going to be lonely if we don't have them. And we're lonely not because we don't have a good relationship. We're lonely because the Spirit of God, we have not allowed the Spirit of God to work in our lives. The Bible is saying that we this year need to start putting some of this stuff in its place. We got to start putting some people in their place in our lives. Sometimes we're addicted to success, money, and jobs, and some of us just addicted to addictions. We smoke and drink too much. God wants us to stop, and we need to move on. And if you move on, I guarantee it that God will show himself a new and a fresh way in your life. God has called us to step into new places this new year and put fear away. One of the heaviest things that we struggle with is we get scared to go and move on, to be successful. But God is going to fill us in those spaces. Another thing that God has called us this year is to be a light in dark places. We are called to be a beacon in the dark places. Now, I will tell you, I'm not that old, but one of the things that has aggravated me this year and this time of year is that I have seen the most putrid, most disgraceful stuff said in the name of Jesus in this political season. I said this Sunday. This morning, we went out there, my degree's in history. And there was a time in Alabama during the civil rights movement that you would lose an election if you were seen with the KKK. Now today in 2016, we have a candidate who is claiming to be a Christian, who is having the KKK march with him up there in 2016. And then they asked him, to denounce the KKK. He said no. But you know, he was right over at that college. About a mile in the street. I ain't talking about you if you went there. I apologize. But he was there at that college. You know what the brother was saying? We need a good leader like you. This is 2016, and these are supposed to be Christians. You gotta understand this. You gotta let your light shine, because there's foolishness out here. Last thing here. How do you accept the power of God for this new year? I want us to first understand something that I want to get it even simpler. One of the things that we got to understand is when we are called to do things for God, it's not us, it's the Holy Spirit working through us. If you pray and you yield yourself to God, he will help you. The Bible, listen, this is the thing that works me up. I was talking about, do we have faith? You know what the Bible said? Do you have faith? The Bible said, you know what, you are faithless. But you know what the Holy Spirit said? The Bible says that if you ask God, this is what it says in James. If you ask God, he will give you faith. You don't even have to have it for yourself. Just ask God. He'll give you the faith. And if he asks you to do something, you got to understand he has power set aside for you to do it. God has come out there. We were witnessing to some folks this morning. And like, Barbara, come out here. Brother Chris, I thought you said you were shy. Yes, I'm shy. I really am. Xavier, know that when I be at work, I be hiding in the corner. You know where I used to work? I used to send them back by myself in the cup. Yes, I was shy, but you know what? I had to say something. Because we need to go out here and understand that if God called you to do something, he's giving you the power to do it. And that's why I believe we fail so many times with so many things, is because we go out here and we go out and we say, well, God called us, and we get scared, and then we forget that God has already worked it out and has given us power. And then, you know what, if you feel your weakness, ask him for some more. He is unlimited power. Ooh, that get me stirred up, because we need the Holy Ghost power. That is an absolute blessing that we have the anointing, that we can go ahead and we can have things change. So lastly, how do we accept the power of God in our lives in this new year, number three? I'm going to go through these real quick. Number one, we need to get seriously dedicated to the things of God. Now, one of the things about that is it makes it so easy because who in here has a smartphone? Who in here has never owned a smartphone? If I don't raise your hand, you never owned a smartphone because you're ashamed of yourself. If you ain't got a smartphone or anything like that, if you never had one before, do you know that the smartphone has a Bible on it? It reads you the Bible. You sign up, it emails you the Bible verses. Y'all got the daily bread? Who reads a little daily bread booklets? Y'all ever have them? Come on, y'all. Amen. When they went out there, you got the daily. Do you know that the daily bread will email itself to you? That's why they call it a daily bread. It emails you. Can you imagine? You know, that was their food. Can you imagine if today you wouldn't want to go eat? Who in here gets cranky and nasty when they don't eat? Y'all need to stop lying. Some of y'all know. Because I done had some of y'all to call me crying, some of y'all to cuss me. Y'all to throw stuff, everything. We need to go out here and eat. I just eat anything. And then we eat you plan. But that food was nasty. Amen. Y'all need to follow your pastor next time. Pastor said go into the cafe, y'all went down the street. That's why we don't wait to pass that nasty food. But anyhow, if you don't eat, you know what happens to you. You get cranky, you can't see, you're tired. Can you imagine what happens to our soul when we don't eat? That's why I call it the daily bread. And it makes it so easy. If the Bible will email itself to you, it'll read to you. It got all type of action. You get the British guy, you can get the American guy. You can get the woman to read to you. You got all these people who will read to you. All you got to do is pick it up. But what God is saying this new year, we have got to get into the things of the Word and start studying. Now, one thing I think that, to be honest, I think I got to get a little bit more practical, is that I believe that people have failed to study their Word because deep down in their heart, they feel that their Word, the Word of God, is to beat them up and has beat them up, or something that's going to take away their fun. But you got to read it, because that's not true. And so people got in there with that fear, that, oh, I'm going to read something that's going to mess up my life. And it may mess up your life, but it's going to mess up your life in a good way. You know, I wanted to be a doctor. Now, I couldn't add. But I wanted to be a doctor. Be out there, let me tell you, if I was ever a doctor, don't ever come to my practice, because I couldn't handle it. I'd be out there even sitting out there walking around, your eye hanging off your head because I had to mess up your prescription. He messed up my life. He said, it's time for you to go out there and preach to the poor. And this morning I was talking with my mom. And she was really upset because I was talking about the old churches that I had went to. And I said, oh yeah, well that's good that you can visit. I will never visit that church. I can't visit that church because they preach against me. I could have went and followed the plan and been the big head honcho, and I could have stayed in the closet and lonely. I could have married me a pretty brown-skinned woman that was tall with a long, with hair coming all down her head, and I could have did that. But you know what? That would have been a lie. But you know what? I wouldn't have faking the fault. I remember one day, my mom, if you ever seen a video of me when I was younger, she said, well, you didn't have a conviction back then. She said, you seemed like you were just born a kid. And she got, it was so funny, I had a video of me when I was a youth pastor. And I was like, I'm preaching hard. All the kids lay down asleep. And everybody was laughing. I was the only one that knows why. Because I didn't have a conviction. I was preaching a lie. Because they all out there living their truth. And I'm sitting over here telling them a lie. I'm sorry, that's free for you. We need to get a devotional plan. Let me get back on those. Number two. We need to get connected to the spiritual family. You know the best part of our ministry here is I like to watch y'all go and hang out. And I love to hear your stories. I love to watch everybody interact. I love that. Because some of y'all are just the greatest people to hang out with. Some of y'all are so queenie, and y'all tell the most interesting stories. And I just love watching your lives. And y'all just make me laugh so much. And then you tell stories and you're looking at the pictures at the museum and y'all looking at, why that look like that? and microwave porn and stuff. I love that. But what you gotta do is you gotta connect with a spiritual home. God's gonna bring us closer together. I love it. God's gonna bring us closer together. Let me say that one. God's gonna bring us closer together.
Amen.
Because he's God. Let me tell you, I love all y'all, but you know I love my sleep. And so other people, y'all can go pick up so-and-so, y'all can go and get your nails done together and get your hair done, you weave and dye and all that stuff. But God will bring us together as a family. But that's a spiritual thing. Don't think that's just, oh, we just blood and blood. That's a spiritual thing. Number three, what we need to do is we need to start reproducing ourselves in this new year. Now, one of the things is we just got to start talking about the Lord. Begin to start talking about the Lord. That's what I mean. Number four, we need to get busy in this community. Get busy. Start handling. We got flyers over there. Them flyers cost a lot of money. Well, no, they didn't. But they cost some money. They're beautiful, though. It took me a long time to do them flyers. And we got flyers, and, you know, people be calling my cell phone because, you know, I had a little card there. They could bump my hand on the card. Well, now we got real flyers. Tell for it. Because let me tell you, I don't know what some of these churches are teaching. I should have said, but I remember we had blessed a young lady, and it is the worst part when we have to go bless people, and we have to drive past their church and do what their church is supposed to do for them. And we sitting here, we ain't got as much money as them, but we still blessing them. But that's okay, because when we start giving out, God starts blessing us tremendously. Another thing, we need to understand that the power of God is just not a religious thing. It's just not a denominational thing. We a lot of times, and I talk about our Pentecostal faith. One of the things that I was talking about, we had a good discussion with Apostle Watson. We talked about a whole lot of other stuff. And it's a whole lot of stuff we can't talk about in church. But we talked about how they went down there and the woman had got the Spirit. She had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And we were talking about how the old traditional church, I know I'm going to take people off now to talk about folks. We were talking about folks, they have the services where you got to pray for 15 hours for the Holy Ghost, and you got to clap and purge and wear this outfit. And then people were like, we were telling the folks, we were like, when I got the Holy Ghost, I just went up and prayed, the Holy Ghost fell on me. And people out here, they did all these traditional stuff. Y'all been in those service where you got to pray for 15, they got to clap, and the old women got to have the doorless on, and y'all, I'm sorry, y'all go on the internet and look that stuff up. Y'all old Baptists, y'all didn't do that stuff. But those old Pentecostals, you know how it is. You get up there, you got to sit in church for 5 hours, or you ain't got the Holy Ghost. I want us to really seriously claim that heritage, but not claim the foolishness.